G'day, ajmahari here, and in this video I'm going to be talking about healing from borderline and or narcissistic abuse for loved ones. Whether a person has borderline personality or narcissistic personality disorder or comorbidly both. Very painful reality to have to deal with in one's life, and even sometimes I know I dealt with it in the past in my life, and even sometimes now with clients. A few, rather make it impossible. And that's a sad thing. So, a little bit about me. I'm a counselor, life coach, mental health, and personal development coach. I work with people from some of my own life experience, having been where you may well be now. I also have considerable college and university education that also contributes to my understanding of how painful it is to be abused by someone with borderline personality or narcissistic personality disorder. And I've been writing online, doing podcasts, hosting a radio show, podcast and radio show when time permits, and I've authored many ebooks and audio programs that I also narrate the audio programs. With e-courses coming soon too, or depending when you're watching this video, check ajmahari.ca or ajmaharieCourses.com, and they may well be there already. I've been working with clients in many niche areas online since 1995, which at the time of recording this video in August of 2015 is 20 years. I care for and work with all. That means both sides. That means people who have BPD, people who are loved ones of those with BPD, people who have BPD and or NPD, people who are loved ones of those people with NPD, people with other personality disorders, other issues, abandonment, fears, codependency, family members of adult children, parents of those with BPD and or NPD. So I hope that, you know, people will watch the videos and most apply to them and take care if they're watching the other side, because I never mean anybody any disrespect. And I've walked in the shoes from the inside out as someone who recovered from borderline personality in 1995. And I had two parents, each comorbid borderline personality and narcissistic personality, with also my father being alcoholic and other issues being there and in my family of origin in general as well. And I know the painful territory of being the adult child of borderline narcissistic parents, and really a toxic dysfunctional family of origin in which many people had one or the other of both personality disorders throughout the generations. And, oh yeah, like I said, my father was also an alcoholic. So I help people in all different parts of this process on both sides, as no two people on either side are in the same place or experiencing exactly the same thing. Things are very much common, but each person is an individual, and I like to respect that and meet people where they are. I also work with adult children needing closure. When no one else will help you with that, it can still be done. And I'm going to have e-courses up about that, and of course, if you are interested, you could book a session or sessions with me. So I just wanted to say also here, I have much more information coming for loved ones of BPD, NPD. I'm available to do two new clients if you want to book a session or sessions and work with me. And I will honor your process and answer all your questions. You can watch more videos, visit my website below to find links to my products and services to help you. You can only change you. It's really important to know that. I mean, on more than an intellectual level. I also have hundreds of blog posts, online articles at the site below and elsewhere. All my sites and information, including e-courses, e-books, videos for sale, audio programs, podcasts, hundreds of free blog posts are linked from ajmahari.ca. So that's a little bit about me. So how are you likely feeling, or have you felt or been feeling, if you need to heal from the abuse of someone with borderline personality disorder, narcissistic personality disorder, or both coexisting in one person, which makes their abuse much more damaging to others? Though how we feel on the receiving end of BPD, NPD abuse, whether it's one or the other personality disorder or both, we cannot compare or measure one person's pain with another in any accurate way, nor do we want to. But what is clear, as I've experienced in the past in my life, from my family of origin, and from a relationship with someone with comorbid BPD, NPD, who was also an alcoholic, and from clients with either and or comorbid BPD, NPD, but specifically, excuse me, more so with BPD, NPD, comorbid, is that it is very painful to be on the other side of what is really transference, projection, projective identification, accusations, blaming, that really is thrown at you, but is really what is going on for the person with BPD, NPD, or comorbidly both. You know, we end up feeling invisible to their wants, their needs, demands, tirades, rage, silent treatments, verbal abuse, gaslighting, future faking, lying, by the way, and so much more, and the never-ending ways they either idealize you or devalue you, or one minute one thing, one minute the other. And they often will give, if you try to ask for responsibility, they might give you some kind of really unapologetic apology. And there's more to come on that in this video. So the thing is, these ongoing cyclical patterns of everything being about them and their inability to relate in healthy ways that hurt you like hell, to put it mildly, until you learn how to detach, observe and not absorb, and take good self-care and or move on. But the key thing here is to be aware of all that you need to get aware of, because you can only help yourself or be helped by someone like me to help yourself. You can only create change for yourself. You can't rescue, change, or help the person with BPD or NPD or comorbidly both. And that's really important to keep in mind, even though it's very difficult emotionally. Like, you can know that intellectually and still find it next to impossible to not try to rescue them emotionally. So, healing from BPD and or NPD abuse is not as simple as the steps in this pyramid by any means. When you get to the top, it's not all fixed. That's not how people work. It takes time, and it is not easy, but the process of healing from this and making tough decisions about relationships and things of that nature will prove itself to be so worthwhile if you just continue on or begin that journey. Recovering from the abuse of a person with BPD and or NPD requires engaging a process of accepting what and who you cannot change. Also, radically accepting who this person is, other than who you thought they were or wished they'd get back to or had hoped for or still may hope for them to be. Radically accept who they really are today. This involves a process of loss and grief, a process of forgiveness also down the road, but that's a process of remembering and letting go, not saying that what was done or is being done to you is okay at all. Often a process of not staying in contact with someone who is not working on their own recovery, because the abuse is everywhere, and it's so damaging, wounding, and hurtful for you. So in this pyramid, you know, first we have to identify the problem. And if you're watching this video, you've probably identified a major part or many parts of the problem. Diagnosis, well, you know, not recommending that people diagnose their partners or loved ones or what have you, but getting them to diagnosis, well, you might not be able to, so you might just read online and kind of deduce for yourself, and that'll be in place of a diagnosis if they're not formally diagnosed. Treatment, well, right here, if this resonates with you, that you're being abused by or suffering from, like really in pain because of somebody that you care about with BPD or NPD, then really the treatment here I'm talking about is what I offer people, in life coaching or counseling or both, to help you, you know, to get more clear about how to take care of you, no matter what decisions you may or may not want to make right now or may not be thinking about right now. And you can make continued progress in being able to take better care of yourself and in getting hurt less, no matter what your loved one still continues to do. And then at the top where it says fixed, I would say enlightened. You become much more enlightened, aware, much more knowledgeable, much more skillful, much more able to deal with things that are presented to you in healthier ways, even though the person that you're dealing with or who's still abusing you with narcissistic or borderline abuse may still well be doing the same thing. But at the top of that pyramid for you, it's not about fixed. It's about skillfulness and not biting the hooks and not going around in the chaotic, dramatic cycles with the person with EPD, NPD, or come over to both, who is so unaware of what they're doing often, but still responsible for it, and so, for lack of a better word, married to or comfortable with all that chaos and cyclical drama that you find or you may be finding is just way too much for you and hurts too much and gives you like brain fog and you don't have a clue what to do with it. So just know that that's kind of a symbolic, process there in terms of the pyramid, but not exactly as it says on the top. So, the pain of loving someone, maybe for a short period of time right now, maybe for years, a long period of time, maybe it's a parent, maybe it's your adult child, but really loving someone from your capacity to, in the middle of life where sort of mental health or mentally healthy living exists on the spectrum of all things human, there's so much pain. And if you're in that pain today, please know that you don't have to remain there. And please know that you don't deserve it. And please know there's nothing that's about this kind of pain of narcissistic and borderline abuse and or both that you deserve. And there's nothing about that that has anything whatsoever to do with love. So we want to knock that pain. We want to work on clearing out that pain, dealing with that pain, making choices and decisions about how you're going to do that. And so the bowling ball in the metaphor here with the pain that are the bowling pins is therapy or getting help or life coaching. I offer therapy and life coaching, but the thing is, whatever you're most comfortable with. And just know that if you want to work with me, you'll be talking to somebody who knows how you feel, not just somebody who learned from books. So, I do help people who have been loved ones or close to someone or who still are with BPD and or NPD or comorbidity both. And these people have hurt you. And immensely, I'm sure. And so with their abuse, whether they realize it or take responsibility for it or not, I have been where you are. I offer counseling and life coaching and have specialized in this area for loved ones of those with personality disorders for 20 years now. You really can't do it alone. I hope you'll visit ajmahari.ca if you want to purchase a session or sessions, and to find out when my e-courses on healing from BPD and or NPD abuse will be available. There'll be many courses with aspects of the process broken down. So what is borderline, what is borderline abuse? Well, key points to be aware of that mean you are being abused by someone with borderline personality disorder include the following, but not limited to the following: patterns of idealization alternating with devaluation, splitting, painting you all black or all white. So in other words, really loving you and feeling great about you in the painting you white idealization phase, and really the opposite. You're the bad guy. You did something wrong. You don't understand. You don't care. Painting you black devaluation phase, and these splits can happen in minutes, hours, patterned ways, of days or weeks, and can involve, by the way, rage or silent treatment, so acting in or acting out. There's nothing you do or say that can help. You get blamed. You might be being raged at or screamed at, is very intimidating, which is abuse, to intimidate someone. You may be experiencing the silent treatment from the person with BPD in your life as opposed to the raging and screaming. I think both equally are just as damaging and abusive. So for a period of time, you know, you might be close and things might seem okay. And then conflict, you know, the person with BPD uses this, it creates it maybe from the simplest of issues to push you away. Well, and then they'll feel abandoned by you. So it's like push-pull, no win, you know, nothing you say kind of works. And that's why I work with a lot of people to help them out, too, to be skillful. You know, DBT skills for family members and loved ones help a lot, as well as they can help those with BPD. And so if you're being, if you're a person who's experiencing abuse from somebody with borderline personality disorder, you probably are aware of their frantic fear of abandonment to the point sometimes of paranoid accusations against you, needing to know or demanding to know all your comings and goings, or look at your phone because they're just sure that you're going to like leave them or be cheating on them, or a myriad of things that often, sadly, I have to report that they're actually doing, but they're worried about that you're going to do in that projective identification kind of way, where you just represent the mirror to what's going on inside them and also maybe perhaps some of their actions. So people with BPD can be emotionally, verbally, psychologically abusive, as well as, you know, financial abuse, which is, you know, just keeping you away from money or withholding money or keeping, you know, a certain portion of income aside, just not maybe dealing with money in your relationship the way that you've agreed to. And also domestic abuse and violence is possible in many cases, not all, but many. And a pattern of controlling behavior and right fighting is definitely some of the gaslighting abuse that people with borderline personality disorder can definitely visit on loved ones. And it's very difficult to know what to do when that's happening because it's so painful. And it also does often hook loved ones into reacting in ways that they're not used to behaving because it really hurts down deep. So if you're being abused by someone with borderline personality, you might also sense they have an overdependence on you, at least if they're idealizing, if they're kind of devaluating, maybe not so much. They have learned helplessness and neediness, which plays itself out in ways where you're supposed to be the enmeshed code, and you might have some codependence, it's something to be aware of, but you're supposed to be the one doing for them what they don't want to do or feel they can't do for themselves. And that's kind of getting into the definition of codependence. But they can be really demanding of things like that. And that's abusive, to be demanding. Demanding that you sacrifice yourself to meet their needs more often than not. And then what happens to your time or ability or, you know, reserve left over to meet your own needs? Because your needs will relatively rarely, if ever, after the honeymoon phase, be met by the person with borderline personality disorder. You'll experience in this borderline abuse accusations and blaming you for how they feel. The quote, I hate you, don't leave me, unquote. The quote, get away closer, unquote. The rage of a borderline false self in the absence of a known self. In other words, projecting everything out on you that they're feeling and or doing, but saying you're feeling it or doing it, or you're making them feel it and you're doing it to them. Collapsing the victim, basically, when you try to ask, you know, like, hey, what's going on or whatever. So it's a no-win situation every which way you move. It's like some crazy game of I don't know what, but all the pieces keep on going over to the person with BPD side because you don't really know what the rules of the game are. Not that there's rules, but you know what I mean. The boundaries or what they're going to do next or that kind of thing. They're very unpredictable. They can become predictable, but they're still unpredictably predictable. So they can often abuse through distortion campaigns. That's lying about you to others, about things that have no basis in reality that may damage your reputation, your career, all kinds of things. But at the end of the day, even if it's not those really big important things, it will very much hurt you, and it is betrayal. They also abuse by trying to hold a loved one accountable. Like, if you try to hold a loved one accountable, they'll collapse the victim, trying to make it all your fault. And then you're effectively dealing with an emotional 2 or 3 year old, and you know, they're not 2 or 3, and you're not their parent, you know. And so that's a tough situation, because they're abusing you and getting away with it. With no accountability or personal responsibility, will they collapse to a victim, and you just feel like you're dealing with a child, emotionally speaking, and then what are you supposed to do? You know, so it's very binding. All the ways that people with BPD can present this abusive stuff at, you know, to you, towards you, aim it at you, not take personal responsibility, not have awareness of it, creates just impossibility in a no-win situation always for you, not to mention the ever-popular, named after the book, or the phrase that the book used, walking on eggshells. Because even when you walk on eggshells, you're going to break them in the borderline's mind and perception. Triangulation is a huge part of borderline abuse, because you become object other. It has to do with their triggered emotional dysregulation, and sometimes they're usually very unaware of that, unless they've had a certain amount of treatment. But when you become object other versus an ally of the borderline, you become like enemy number one. And what that means is that they're not even seeing you. They're seeing like a parent figure or whomever really hurt them in the past. But the point is, so you're invisible in that moment. That's why that hurts so much. And there's nothing you can say or do that's going to help them to be able to discern that it's not you doing what they're accusing you of or projecting at you. It's really coming from them in their past, but they're not going to get that often. And you can feel less and less seen, which can be very painful, and less heard, right, for who you are, as you are punished more and more for not being the, quote, good enough parent object. Or if you are the parent of an adult child with borderline personality, then not being the not good enough parent. And not all parents who have children and then adult children with borderline personality are the not good enough parent. Some are, but many aren't. As well, 25% at least aren't. And either way, you're being devalued, and the things are being demanded from you at the same time, it just is abusive, okay? Because the other person with borderline personality isn't able to take any personal responsibility for the things that we know as adults we have to be responsible for, so that we wouldn't even go into any of this, let alone all of this. And there's much more, too. I just had to condense it down in this video. So if you're being abused by somebody who's a narcissist, it's going to be highly involving gaslighting, twisting reality or twisting your words or what is said or understood so much that they impose their distorted, self-centered, self-absorbed, and unaware truth onto you. This is among the worst of narcissistic personality disorder abuse if you're not aware of it. Once you're more aware of it and you know how to deal with it, that's one thing. But if it's just catching you off guard and you don't know which one is up at that point, and it's very painful, people doubt themselves, people sometimes even break down, people feel like they're losing themselves, or in fact they are losing themselves, it's a very dangerous place to be on the other side of a gaslighting narcissist. So you really need to understand more about what that's about, and how they work, what they're working there, and why. Also, narcissists will abuse by accusing you of doing to them what they're doing to you, as they make their accusation and blame you. They might say, well, you're shaming me. You're blaming me. You're not listening to me. You don't care about me. You're not hearing me. All of which will be true about the narcissist doing the accusing and not about you. And if you try to reflect that back, they will often explode because they can't hear what they're actually doing. They can't tolerate to hear what they're actually doing. So it's quite the catch-22. You're getting hurt by accusations and things that don't apply to you, and how are you supposed to get them to see that? Well, you often can't, and that's why you have to learn how to take care of yourself when these active abusive situations are taking place. People with narcissistic personality disorder or comorbidly BPD and NPD are exploitative, really exploitative, and want what they want, when they want it, exactly how they want it. And I say good luck, I don't mean to be light about it, but no one can meet this demanding entitled criteria ever, because it'll never be good enough. These people are never satiated unless and until they can get into help and treatment and find out where the pain's really coming from in the past and how to cope and deal with and heal that. They also want to control who you are, how you are, according to their every whim of feelings, needing, wanting, and all they need and want that is abusive to demand from you. They lie more than they ever tell the truth, even after, and many will even admit that they were lying to you in the past, and then give unapologetic apologies, if any at all, and lie to you again in the future. And then you'll come to know, if you haven't already, what the lies are and when they're most evident, because, you know, it becomes quite a cyclical pattern, unfortunately. Narcissists are future faking. They don't know, they're so unaware of their own selves or lack thereof, and they don't know how they're affecting other people because they simply don't really know how to be aware of anything outside of self, self-absorption, self-centeredness, self-need, because they just frankly don't care about other people in the way that the rest of us do. They don't have the capacity, we might say they've been wounded so they can't. But it's hard to know who knows how much about what in terms of awareness with that. So, future faking is lying about the future as if their fantasies are going to be reality for you or them someday, just as they may lie about the now or the past. A lot of lying. And future faking is like, I'll change, I'll get better, I won't do it again, or we're going to be, you know, madly in love, we're going to have this great relationship, when there's no basis whatsoever for thinking that. But they just kind of, well, if you're in a relationship with someone, that's different. But if you're not, like, I work with clients who do this, and they think we're going to be in a relationship, and they make the whole thing up. It's called erotic transference in that case. But the point is, anyway, they do that. And then they kind of hold your feet to the fire as if somehow you're on board with their fantasy. So it's a lot of gaslighting and a lot of future faking and a lot of fantastical thinking, magical thinking. So, you know, they get this grandiose fantasy-like entitled magical thinking whereby everything they have to say is righter or more important than what you say or believe. I mean, I've experienced that with a few clients with comorbid BPD, NPD, and I think people experience that in other relationships as well. In which case it might be even more difficult to deal with because it's difficult enough to deal with when a client is being abusive and not realizing it or blaming me for everything, just as people in your life could be doing to you. So narcissists will often pretend they care or they're trying to care or they think they care when really they can't even remember a thing you told them pretty much because if it's not about them, they're just bored. They don't care. They zone out. They don't listen well. They'll interrupt. They'll tell you how you're supposed to be talking to them for them to listen to you. And just things that are just like unimaginable, really, until you go through them. They have a lack of mutuality and reciprocity at times to the point of zero. That means there's you're giving, they're taking. They rarely give back, if ever, and if they do, it's probably a lie or future faking or magical thinking, unfortunately, or a desperate attempt to maybe get you to not walk out the door and get on with your life and heal. But it's usually not. It's exploitative. It's manipulative. And by the way, if I didn't put it on the screen, they're very, very, very manipulative most of the time. So that's another thing to watch out for. And they have a lack, or a total absence of empathy and compassion for others. And they may think they're very empathic and compassionate, but that's just, again, the magical fantasy thinking. It's not who they really are. They could be very charismatic and full of charm, but they're verbs, not nouns. And you end up getting played because that's all about being the wolf. Being the wolf in sheep's clothing. You may be being told how often you just aren't what they expect, or you just aren't good enough, or what they believe and feel is what matters. Not anything like, you know, what they think, what they think and believe matters, and not anything that you think or believe. You couldn't possibly know anything more than they do. That's how that can come across quite a bit. And to disagree with a narcissist, and they'll either go silent right away, or silent at first and explode, or they'll just explode into a fit of blaming, rage, and say things, all kinds of things, but several things I've heard from clients that I've had like this are, I can't tolerate that, they'll say, to just try to keep you to not go there, or I can't stand it, I don't feel safe, I don't feel comfortable, I don't like it. Basically, they're just trying again to exert gaslighting control and have you not have your opinion when you are entitled to your opinion and to not have to agree with them. Do you feel like the person with BPD or NPD or both in your life? Do you feel like it's always about them? Are you lost to their triggers, to the past? Do you feel invisible? Do you wonder where the person you first got to know and love went? Are you the parent or adult child of someone with BPD or comorbid NPD or one or the other? And are you still longing for that parent or parents to be the parents you needed, but just never had? There's an abandonment suffered on the other side of people who are abusing you. There are reasons why people let it go on so long often. And it's way too long. Are you confused? Are you feeling like you don't know who you are anymore? Are you isolating or being isolated from family and friends? People at work ask you if you're okay, and then you lie to them and say you are, but you're really not. You don't have to stay in this pain at all. You don't need to be in this pain alone either. You cannot look to the person who's hurting you, negating you, gaslighting, abusing you for help. They're not able to help themselves, let alone you. They're just not capable of it. Do you know what you need now? Because it doesn't match with what you want. You really need what you know you need more than staying stuck in abuse, hoping to get the person you want them to be back, or that you thought they were back. And really, that's not going to be possible, because who you're seeing now is a person who they really are. So that's about radically accepting that, and that's a loss. People with NPD or BPD or both give mixed messages and make accusations all the time. That is true of them, not you. I was vulnerable, but the narcissist in my life just kept using that to lie to me, manipulate me, gaslight me when I didn't even know what that means. And tell me I never did anything right enough or good enough for them, or the way they wanted whatever they wanted. They always wanted more or something different. It's never enough and it's never right. That's unfortunately how these people feel. The person with borderline personality, she said she loved me so very much. She played on my feelings in ways that I don't know how to get over. Who is she really? I think I know, but it's so sad and painful to think it's over or that it needs to be over. I don't really know if I want to know. Can you relate to that? He told me he loved me and he was wonderful until we got married. Then the rages, the devaluation, things I never had heard about myself, things that were true of him, not me. These are what clients report to me. And as someone who works with people with BPD and NPD, I've had some of the same things said to me and done to me in different ways because of transference, so I totally understand how you must be feeling, and I really have answers to help people through the process. So many try so hard for so long not to give in or give up. Yet the pain, it keeps getting undeniably worse. You do not deserve the way you are hurt, being abused. There is nothing about love involved from the person with BPD and or NPD or comorbidity both. And you, your love, can't penetrate their, quote, projective identification, all the defense mechanisms, their triggered emotional dysregulation, their rage, or even the place inside where, yes, in a way, they are screaming to be helped. They can't be helped by you. And the sooner you accept that, the sooner you can look to getting out of the maze of NPD, BPD, or comorbidly BPD, NPD. Sadly, too often the borderline and or the narcissist are not aware of needing help. They think all their problems are because of you. They are habitual blamers and accusers, by the way. It is you that you need to help. I help the loved ones who want to get help to get out of this abusive pain cycle, this maze of utter agony of loving someone who is abusing the you know out of you. The war that is seemingly out of, quote, love, unquote, is really a battle waged for the narcissist and the borderline from their pasts. It isn't about you. You need to know now you cannot rescue them. They cannot change without professional help. You can only change yourself, love yourself enough to do that. If you feel like crying help like the little character in the middle of the maze, then I'll hope that you'll take action upon that and get some help. There's no shame in that. These people present unbelievably vortex-like, maze-like emotional situations that people get caught up and trapped in and so hurt by. And clients often say to me that they just want this person with BPD and NPD, or I mean BPD or NPD or both, to get the help they need to change. Well, that's understandable, but not controllable by you. Not controllable by me either. Some will engage in therapy for years, but finding the therapist to be right more than getting well. Clients who find themselves trapped between, quote, toxic love, unquote, and a breaking or broken heart often benefit from looking at their own past issues. That's what a loved one can control. That's what you can control, yourself, not the other person. And I have clients with comorbid BPD, NPD, or sometimes borderline personality and sometimes narcissistic personality that equally, you know, tell me that I don't know what I'm talking about. They know way better than me. They need to take breaks. They try to control the whole process of how I work with them, and that's a clinical fundamental treatment modalities, and they just totally like, no, they throw it out the window. So even people that you love and care about that might be getting help don't really count on that they're actually learning versus fighting the therapist the way they fight you and everyone else. So here's the thing, really, okay? So very many loved ones of those with BPD and or NPD, comorbid or separate, even family members have codependency issues. And I know I did as well in the past. And they're really painful issues, you know? People think, that's nothing. Well, it's not like a personality disorder, but it's not nothing either. It's very painful. These issues may stem from your own family of origin. And unfortunately, if you have codependent tendencies or codependent traits, or you are just kind of codependent, you really want to help people, you know, you're kind of a fixer, a rescuer, somebody who really cares, gives a lot. Well, that's a great fit for somebody with borderline personality or narcissistic personality, because if you want to give, they're more than happy to take and take and take and take and take and take. Till you're so worn out. You're wondering, why is it that I don't have to give what I used to have to give? Or in giving it, you're losing yourself, because they will take and take and take and take some more. Without conscience, without apology, they'll just take. So that's a painful, painful fit for the person on the other side of somebody with BPD or NPD. A fit that really, in any healthy sense of the word fit, is not a fit at all. Healthy relationships are not about fighting for love. They are not one-sided. They are not about disrespect. They are not about abuse at all. You deserve so, so very much more. Even in my work with some BPD clients, mainly NPD, and or BPD, comorbid NPD clients, I myself have experienced, as well as in my personal life in the past, being blamed one minute and then told after being raged at and accused of what the client is often doing, that I mean so much to them or that I'm someone they care about and need. And I've also had a few clients like this that out of all my 20 years, not too many, a couple few, that don't realize that it's not me they're at war with. And yet it's, you know, because it's a, you know, object, parent, transference in a therapeutic way, therapeutic way. But yet it's me that's getting abused, even in sessions, a low percentage of clients do this. But that means I have to end working with people who abuse me. And often, you know, like, I've had clients, a couple clients lately, where it's like, you know, it's been an ongoing war for so long, too long, and then, you know, they need to take a break or go do other things or whatever for a bit, and then they're, I guess, coming back, or I don't know what they're thinking, but, you know, it gives a person pause, and maybe you've experienced this in your life, where maybe you get away from this person for a little while, and the next thing you know, you're not so sure that you want to go through that anymore whatsoever. Anyways, if you can relate to this, please check out my website, some other videos, things that are out there for free. And if you'd like to, you know, check into my e-courses when I get them up and available. At the time of this recording, they're not there yet. Or if you'd like to book a session with me, by all means. But, you know, hey, if it's not me, if I'm not the one for you, then definitely find somebody who is, if this resonates with you. And then on the last slide of this video, just some testimonials, and I'm really not going to say anything about them, except to say that you can pause and read if you care to, or you can just move on. And I appreciate your viewing this video. I hope that you got something out of it. I know there's a lot of text and I went rather quickly, and still this is a long video, but do feel free to pause it. Do feel free to watch it over again if it resonates with you, if you find it helpful. And in the meantime, if there's anything else you want to know, or you want, you know, go to ajmahari.ca. There's a contact form there. You can ask me questions. If you're interested in counseling or life coaching with me, by all means, you know, feel free to ask me whatever kind of questions you would like. But just know, if you're with somebody with borderline personality, narcissistic personality, especially comorbidly both, you really, really need to educate yourself, and more than just intellectually, because I know so many of you out there, by the time you find this video, you probably know about as much as I know, or close to as much as I know about what the problems are, but maybe not the solutions, huh? And that's where I could come in and help you. But my point is, what you know intellectually is not going to help you to deal with the way you're getting abused and broken down and hurt so badly emotionally. And that's why you're in so much pain, because your intellect can't protect you emotionally from these people that are, especially comorbid BPD, NPD are, or NPD people are really exploitative, unapologetically just takers, lacking empathy and lacking compassion. So it's a no-win situation for you. And if you haven't realized that yet, I hope you really give some thought to that. So until next time, take the very best care of yourself you can now. And remember, I know it's painful where you are. It might be painful to look at changes, but nothing's as painful as where you might be right now. So think about that. It's difficult, but it's a well worth it road, a journey, a process of healing to take.